Good afternoon, and distinguished ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to talk about Africa. And I said I won't write a speech. I'll just discuss it and share with some of my African people here how we can help youth and how we can help emerging businesses and help to bridge that digital divide that is still separating us in Africa with the whole world. I cannot but help to say that as I'm talking, I would like the video showing some youths that have been empowered, that have been shown and taught how to lay their hands on. No, you can reduce the volume. We don't need the volume. Just the picture. Okay, and I will talk over it. Now, one of the major challenges we've had in Africa is that we're still being kept at the back there. I remember 14, 15 years ago when we used to go to China, I used to see a lot of houses, you know, those pictures we all used to see at CNN in those days. And today you go to China, it's a different story. Why is it not happening in Africa? I think it's about time we start from the scratch. And the first step is, how do we start our own businesses? How do we create SMEs? How do we move from one step to the other? Because once you have started to walk, you can't stop but keep running. And basically, that's the concept in which I'm going to discuss today. I'll use a little of my personal example here, because I've addressed a lot of forums, youth forums especially, and the first question is, how do we start? Do we have to be a doctor, a nurse, a this? I took off as a chemical engineer. And how did I get into computer? Was just out of need. That's why I believe Africa would do it. Because sometimes when you are not privileged, when you are in need of something, you'll be forced to think. That's why I like the cap that was given to us in the gifts cap, that we should think. We'll be forced to think. I had a major project as my graduating project. And this was to connect the kinetics with biochemical engineering. And I had two groups of supervisors, two universities combined together to do this project. And I was supposed to be studying the simulation, the lifespan growth of organisms under different conditions, and to now use computer simulations, iterations to analyze this report. I was then faced with only the Fortran thing that we're all studying in schools that in those days, and there was no way I could keep up with the pace. So I was forced to join my lecturer that brought the old XT computer in the past from Rochester in the US. And I learned that you could use something called Lotus to do some mathematical iterations and get the result of what you want. And that was how the project was done within a very short period compared to what they thought I would use. And then they kept on enlarging the project. In short, to cut the story short, this was how chemical engineering to computers. I finished immediately, and I realized that on coming out, there was a need for people to know how to use the computers to do what they were doing. And Nigerians, we used to have a lot of oil money then. A lot of people bought these computers, but they didn't know what to do with the computers. That's the lesson too, which means we don't need to just say we start from anywhere. We can also create a niche in trying to capture what we want to do. So I was quick in going from one executive to the other, right in 1986, to start training executives on how to use computers. You know, the way executives will have a swimming lesson, 4 to 5, maybe squash lesson, 6 to 7. So I used to tell those older men that just see it like your golf lesson. And this was how I started by training these executives. And it metamorphosed into training bankers, staff of companies, staff of organizations. And And it was growing. And this is what I've told a lot of youth, that if you think it's a small thing you've started, just keep on doing what you are doing, and it will keep moving. Because we need to keep our people busy. Our people are very intelligent people. And I noticed I was being driven. One person tells the other one tells the other, and it kept on going like that. And it even went beyond that. It went into now the same people you've trained trusting you to sell the hardware to them. And before I knew it, I got into selling of hardware. You see, which means it's really easy for us to start up a lot of things in Africa here. Because, you know, we know how to endure in Africa. So we can actually take off in a very simple way. We became, in 88, which was 2 years after, maybe I need to say that because a lot of people have been faced with the same kind of challenge. I was not being given checks any longer in my name. So I needed to incorporate a name. Because once you now start growing to teach corporate organizations other than individuals, you need to start being professional. You need to start being corporate. So I was forced to incorporate a name. The first name that came to my head then was my village name. And I put TEK Technology at the back. And I got my check. And this was how I thought it was the beginning of a new era. And I started with that. Before I knew it, we started selling the likes of Compaq, IBM. And the story of selling Compaq and IBM is another dimension I want Africans to hear. After traveling with them everywhere, before I knew it, we became a premium partner. Premium partner means you are selling like $1 million annually. And I noticed that, I'm sorry to say if Compaq is here, but they were not really producing this from the beginning. And that is a supply chain. And I was beginning to remember my chemical engineering. And I saw that the motherboard is being done by motherboard manufacturers. Other people are doing the hard disk. Other people are doing the memory. Then what are Africans doing? Why can't we do our own? This was in 91. So at that time, I started thinking about it. And luckily, I had been going to Asia. I started peeping more into what the Chinese are doing. The Chinese don't have foreign brands. They house the foreign brands. They house their factories. Their people are the workers. But they were not using the foreign brands. They were using their own brand. Then I knew that was the solution. We too need to bring the Chinese people here to teach us, or bring those people to Africa to teach us what they are doing. And I noticed nicely how the Chinese have gotten a lot of technology by housing some of this. And all of them, there are so many factories in Asia that were being owned by their own people. And every one of us here could own a factory. Yours could be producing just I/O cards. Just about, I got to a village, 10 people were 10 different factories producing the same thing, but named differently. That's unemployment being out of the way. So I came back, and in 1993, I launched Omatek Computers. Then it was a semi-knockdown product, and we were buying from Data Mini, ASA in Dubai, and people were calling us clone people. We didn't mind, we went on. We're still doing the Compaq, we're doing our clone, the so-called clone. But I ask myself, for women here, why can't we do our own products? The same way their own boxes are coming this way, our own boxes going that way. Which is the first step? I met the chief researcher this afternoon of Sun Systems. He said, Florence, when will Omatek start to make or design motherboards? I said, that's the next step. We've just learned how to crawl. We need to move to the next step. Now, what I now did immediately was to find out what they were doing, and I realized that what they were doing was basically buying quality products. Let me give you an example. There are motherboard factories, but they are of different grades. So you have to determine what level of quality of products you want. If two women, because African men are tough men. If two women are being given the same ingredients to cook the same food, I've argued this with a lot of African men. Will the soup taste the same thing? Some said no. Some said yes. So, well, let's start. Let's start from there. So I then said, well, the best step is to go to the same level of manufacturers. And we started buying motherboards from the likes of Intel at the beginning. Today, we're buying motherboards from the likes of Foxconn and so on. A lot of you carry notebooks today. They are not African brand notebooks. My notebook is an Omatek notebook, for example. Why? Because I said, what are these people doing? They are buying from the likes of key manufacturers. I even discovered that in Asia, only few people produce that notebook in semi-knockdown. So with all this, we decided to now go full blast into notebook assembling ourselves. And what are the Chinese people doing? The Chinese people are basically assembling. We used to call them copycats. But is this same logic of two ingredients or same ingredients? We just started with a simple logic. Let's use the same ingredients that is being used by the foreign brand. I personally saw Compaq. I didn't say HP because I had gone into full blast Omatek before they changed to HP. I saw Compaq for 15 years, and today I want my product to be the same. What are Africans doing? We can do the same thing. Don't say because we're Africans, you want to start your product, you want to start it in an inferior quality. Go straight for the quality products. And that was exactly what we tried to do. And although we faced so many other challenges, for example, buying from the same manufacturers, people in Nigeria, for example, thought the pricing has to be 30-40% cheaper than the foreign brands. If not, why should I buy a local brand? Meanwhile, we're buying the same ingredients from the same people. Meanwhile, the amount of money you need to buy is a lot. At the end of the day, most people don't know that these major manufacturers, they have what they call minimum order quantity level. Africa has the population. For notebook factory that we buy from today, we have to buy a minimum of 1,000 at a time, which is about $700,000, which takes me to the other risk. So if we want to face that and have the same quality product, then it means that we should start working into making sure we help ourselves. Bring government policies out that will patronize our own. Chinese will not buy a foreign brand today. The banks were now another major situation. Pricing we could solve to an extent. Why? Because we now started doing more, kept on looking. That was when we realized that labor in Africa is cheaper. But outsourcing is not on this part of the world. Why? Because they thought the labor, because we don't have the capacity, but labor is actually cheap. So which means if we start to do this, we can develop the human labor, the youth will be empowered, employment will be removed, and then things will start moving. Then the other challenge was the one of the banks. I felt the first step was to do a joint venture with the banks, which we did. The first day I heard that our president, that was the last administration, was the first administration, for example, in Nigeria, that I will see somebody really dedicated in growing the economy. And if African leaders can continue in this fashion, then I think we're beginning to get somewhere. He opened up the SME market. He told every bank to denote 10% of their profit to help SMEs. The minute I heard the MD of one of the big banks said it, I went after him. They were already buying our old ones, Omatek. I just went there. And what I now discover, which is also a message I would like to leave, because I noticed there are a lot of investors and bankers too around here, is that banks should learn to help SMEs grow. We had a major problem even after the joint venture because they were still wearing the caps of bankers. They never wore the caps of entrepreneurs or investors, and they never saw themselves as equity shareholders. And these were some of the challenges that I think most SMEs are facing today, the funding. But like I won't want to leave here without mentioning, there are other major factors that, like electricity. Nigeria, for example, we don't have electricity even as much as here. But what have we done? The first 3 years were 100% on generator. Sometimes it's even cheaper than the electricity itself. Because when the NEPA bills came for a short period, we said, let's try NEPA. It was still higher. Whatever rating they were using, I don't know. So, but what I'm saying here, the point I'm saying here is, you don't wait and say until electricity is done before some things come. You can start and go into it. If electricity comes into Nigeria now, we're already 3-4 years in this. So which means we'll quickly plug in into this rather than waiting for it before taking off. Because we need a lot of big SMEs in this country, in this continent for us to move forward. Now, in also trying to bridge the digital divide, I want everybody that has to do with funding to start thinking. We don't even have the resources to own computers in Africa. I had to call one or two bank MDs in Nigeria, and I came up with an initiative I called eExpress, which involved e-youth, e-tertiary for the universities, e-mobile, and so on. But it was so difficult. There were so many criteria. Bankers need to move, loosen up. And move away. That's why I like the word risk takers. I think it's the bankers that should come for this session. You know, and African banks like short term. They don't like long term projects. Let's help people to own computers, and you'll be shocked at what you will see. All these guys you are calling clone builders, so many of them. This was what motivated me when the factory was taken off to start a case industry, speaker industry. The casing, if you look at the thickness is about 0.6, 0.5 mm. Meanwhile, some of the things they bring is about 0.3 mm. And you could help them with that quality. So they come in now to pick things like that and start to build. While they are building, they are learning. They are having hands-on on technology. And these are some of the things we need on outsourcing so that our own people, foreign exchange, can come in and out. And the gentleman that spoke on government, we are praying. We had one last in Nigeria for the last 7 years. We're hoping it works. We're hoping it continues. And then one of the last messages in that section, which I also shared at the last Aspen training, is that most of us in the private sector should start to have some kind of share stakeholders forum with the government so that we'll be part of the policy making. And our own government, we did this. In that forum, it came out with a policy that no ministry should ever buy any foreign brand other than local brand. But he did it in the IT sector because that was the sector in which we were talking, which means other sectors can repeat the same thing and we'll begin to start celebrating our own products. You know, this owning computers had been a major challenge. I have personally, to end this, I have personally spoken with some of these banks, told them the benefit of African youth or Africans owning computers. If you read some of the papers recently, we've now been able to say there are facilities in this bank, there are facilities in that bank. But it took for us to use our corporate security or guarantee to be able to open up certain things. These are some of the challenges we're hoping could be erased for people to start to own their computers. And we are taking this away from just Nigeria. We're doing this in Ghana at the moment. And we're hoping that the same way Compaq and IBM were coming from Europe, although built in Asia, that they will come to African factories to build. And we too will ship some of those boxes out. This is entrepreneurship. This is creating jobs. There is hardly anybody without a job in China. There is hardly a youth without a job in China. And I think this is the beginning. And forums like this could help to generate and sensitize decision makers like you into empowering our youth, into bridging the digital divide, and helping SMEs to thrive. Thank you very much.
Florence, thank you, thank you, thank you. Just one quick question. If there was one thing that's a bottleneck in your business right now that people in this room could help with, what would it be? Is it finance or is it manufacturing assistance, design assistance?
Well, we want to move to the next level in Africa. Now that we're creating funding, the next step is to bring some major factories that are really into designing. Like we want to start designing motherboards in Africa too. And things like that.
Move from manufacturing up the food chain to design.
High tech level.
Thank you for sharing your story with us. Thank you.